So hello and welcome to our online service this week. It's the 28th of March 2021 and it's Palm Sunday. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray, Lord God, that you will bless this time that we spend together. Whether we're in your house this Sunday morning or whether we are watching via the video at some other point in time or place. Lord, because your presence knows no boundaries and no limitations. So I pray that you'll speak to us as we seek to listen to you. Lord, you will bless us and anoint us as we seek to bless your heart with our praise and our worship. Amen. Well, our first song pretty much picks up on where we left off last week. There was a little tune playing at the end of the video, which you may or may not have picked up on, and we're going to start with that today. Now, let me say, as we start this service, we're going to be celebrating because it's Palm Sunday, and the procession of Jesus with his disciples and the crowds into Jerusalem was one of celebration, so we're going to be doing that today, without a doubt. So please, this is biblical. I'll show you later. You can sing, you can dance, you can just enjoy yourself in the presence of God as we have our opening song. Oh Lord, I want to sing your praises, da ba ba.
Hallelujah.
Alleluia. Oh Lord, I want to sing your praises. Sorry about that, but if you come to the church at all regularly, you'll know that I frequently burst into song for no good reason at all, and it's never good. We're going to keep that theme of celebration and praise going. We're going to keep the tempo high with this next song. It's a song that we know very well, but I struggled to find a version to play to you today that I really liked until I came across this one, and I hope and pray that you'll enjoy it as much as I have.
Yes, Lord, you're worthy. And Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Lord, I lift your name on high. I'd love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay.
I just love the energy that the singer there, Miranda Curtis, puts into that worship. It's beautiful. Now we're going to have the reading of the Word of God from Stephanie.
Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 to 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowd answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet, from Nazareth in Galilee."
Thanks, Steph. Another beautiful reading, and you'll have picked up from that it is one of the main places in the Gospels where we turn to for Palm Sunday. It is covered in all four Gospels in some level, and that is Matthew's version of it. I've got to say that I get pulled in different directions with Palm Sunday and the reflections that we make on this triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And I would still like to know who first gave it the name, the triumphal entry. It's kind of stuck in our psyche now. We know it by that. On the one hand, you see, there is the sheer joy of the moment. The crowds are out in force, and they are there to praise Jesus with song, with enthusiasm, with palm branches being waved around, and with their cloaks and their coats being laid on the floor in front of him, giving a real impression of his majesty. On the other hand, it is the joy before the sadness. It is the sweetness of popularity before the bitterness of his betrayal. His treatment as a king before his death as a criminal. And of course, all this would be turned into joy again at the resurrection. But between the triumphal entry and the resurrection, there was a lot of pain to be gone through. Either way, this was a very unusual event, whether you see it as being the portent of a bad time or whether you see it as wonderful and happy in its own right. It had the spontaneity of the crowd seemingly coming from nowhere, breaking these palm branches to wave and placing their coats on the ground, and then shouting this wonderful chant that they used from Matthew 21 verse 9, "Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest heaven." Now that was a biblical chant borrowed from Psalm 118, and we'll look at that a little bit further on in our message. But apart from the spontaneity, there had to be something of a pre-planning of this event. Certainly in Jesus' mind, he was very clear what was going to happen. It was no accident. He knew where the donkey was to be found. He sent his disciples to find it. He gave them the script to use should they be challenged about using those animals. And in all of that, he sought to fulfill an Old Testament prophecy from Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. "Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Now, I'm going to take my lead from that verse because it starts so wonderfully. Rejoice greatly. This was an event of great rejoicing, and rejoicing is good. It may not always seem that the Bible is full of rejoicing. Sometimes we get a bit caught up with the more somber moments, the tragedy, the suffering, the discipline. But in fact, the scripture is also very much full of elements of rejoicing. Look at Exodus 15, verse 20. Then Miriam, the prophet, Aaron's sister, Moses' sister, of course, too, took a timbrel in her hand, and all the women followed her with timbrels and dancing. Well, you might think, and I really don't believe you will think this, that that's all right for the women, but what about for the men? Well, yeah, what about for the men? King David was just as up for it. 2 Samuel 6:14, wearing a linen ephod, David was dancing before the Lord with all his might. Not just gently swaying, with all his might. There is nothing wrong with dancing in the presence of the Lord. In fact, I'm sure it's a great thing to do. It doesn't have to be any kind of special dancing. It doesn't have to be choreographed or rehearsed or anything like that. It's just a matter of making sure that the rest of our bodies join in with what our hands often do when we clap or raise them. And certainly what our voices and faces do when we get involved in singing the praises of our God. The rest of our body is just playing catch up when it dances at the same time that we worship. And we have much to rejoice about. We have much to dance about. Our salvation, which Jesus secured a week or so after this event happened, when he gave himself over to crucifixion, followed by his resurrection, that brought our salvation. And that is the source of our joy. And why wouldn't it be? Our salvation is what gives us eternal life. It's what gives us peace in uncertainty. It gives us strength in weakness. It gives us light in times of darkness. And it gives us hope when everything around us seems to be trouble of some kind or another. Dr. Rick Hansen, who you've probably never heard of, but he blogs on the Psychology Today website, and he says this, which I thought was just lovely. Intense positive emotions include delight, passion, rapture, thrill, triumph, exuberance, elation, and rejoicing. In a word, joy. I'd like to change that. Intense positive praise includes delight, passion, rapture, thrill, triumph, exuberance, elation, and rejoicing. In a word, joy. He goes on to say, finding and protecting joy is worth doing at any time. Joy is a reminder that you are not defeated in the sanctuary of your own mind. Get that. Joy is a reminder that you are not defeated in the sanctuary of your own mind. It's not a cure-all for the mental issues that we sometimes suffer, but it is a bright spark in the difficulties and darkness that those mental issues can bring. I can't imagine that there are any negatives about being joyful. I don't know any study that has come up with a kind of you shouldn't be joyful because it does this to you. I can't imagine that ever existed. Although sometimes it has to be said that we should remind our faces to be joyful because sometimes they don't show it even when we feel it. It's no wonder that joy is the natural outcome of salvation. Back to David again, Psalm 35 verses 9 to 10. Then my soul will rejoice in the Lord and delight in his salvation. My whole being will exclaim, who is like you, Lord? I'd love to know where this crowd on that day came from. I don't mean in the obvious geographical sense from somewhere around the Mount of Olives. I mean, why were they there? What drew them to the place? Did they come up from Bethany with Jesus when he raised Lazarus? Were they present when he healed the blind man just on his way out of Jericho, on his way to this particular event? You read that in the previous chapter in Matthew 20. That's one of the most amazing things about Jesus. You may think that there is a type of person who becomes a Christian, but there really isn't. You will find eminent scientists and supermarket shelf fillers. You will find academics and school dinner ladies as Christians. Rich people, our Queen for example, and those who hardly have any cash at all. We are from all continents and from every direction, every time zone around the globe. There are people who are following Christ because of his love for them and their love for him and that great salvation that we have. It doesn't matter on your political outlook or what hobbies or interests you've got. There is no type of Christian, just people who subscribe to this marvellous faith that we enjoy. But we as them have this one thing in common, that our hope is in Jesus Christ and in no other. Hebrews chapter 12, the end of verse 1, beginning of verse 2. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. Did you notice that the author of Hebrews speaks of Jesus' own joy in all of this? So this triumphal entry, it was a bittersweet moment for Jesus, but it contained for him that element of joy as it contained for those people who were following him. He knew what was ahead of him, but he still approached it with joy. The people following him, of course, didn't know that at all. Neither that crowd nor his disciples had any idea what was about to become of him. And it's fair to say, although they were looking for some kind of salvation from this, they may not have been expecting what was about to happen to them. I'm pretty sure they weren't. It is likely that they were looking for some sort of armed or political release from the grip of Rome. The clue is in those palm branches. They had previously been used by the Jews to celebrate their release from their last oppressor a couple of centuries before the Romans turned up. You can find that story in the apocryphal book of 1 Maccabees 13:51. If you care to look at that, it says, they entered the fort in Jerusalem, singing hymns of praise and thanksgiving whilst carrying palm branches and playing harps, cymbals and lyres. Several of Jesus' disciples were described as zealots. They may have been revolutionaries. We're not really entirely sure what that terminology means. But we do know that they were looking for a kingdom which may not necessarily have been a spiritual one. Maybe they were looking for a release from Rome. And certainly the Pharisees were sure that Jesus could bring a political uprising that would cause them an awful lot of problems. If again you look back at the story of Lazarus, they very soon got concerned by the attention that was being drawn to Jesus, fearing that the Romans would come and clamp down on all of their freedoms to prevent a political uprising. But Jesus never said anything of the sort. Never. His kingdom was not of this world. During his upcoming trial, Pontius Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world." He went on to tell Pilate that he'd got the wrong end of the stick, as indeed some of the others had. In the very next verse, John 18:37, "You say I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world was to testify to the truth." And on that point, the revelers on the road to Jerusalem, expecting release from one kingdom to another, were right to rejoice and celebrate and praise as they had, because truth is what really brings release. Truth is what really brings us freedom. Spiritual truth found in the gospel, which makes liberation complete. John 8:32 says this, Jesus is speaking, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The kingdom of God is liberation. You remember that shout used by the crowd? We read it earlier, Matthew 21 verse 9, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Hosanna simply means save us. And that whole chant was a kind of derivative of Psalm 118 verses 25 to 26. Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The whole of Psalm 118 is messianic. Speaking of Jesus, the cornerstone. Speaking of the love of God for us, enduring forever. Speaking of God as our ultimate defense and as our gateway to righteousness. They could not have picked a better psalm to quote from than that one. I don't know how much they really understood what the kingdom of God was about, as I mentioned a minute ago. I doubt they knew the whole thing, because it was spoken of with some mystery surrounding it by Jesus, even when he was teaching his full disciples. It had not been fully revealed at that time. But they certainly understood the joy of worshipping Jesus, as we should. Forget your stiff upper lip. It's time to open our mouths in worship. Forget standing to attention when the good hymns play. Let's dance as Miriam and David had danced back there in the Old Testament. I'm going to go back to Psalm 118. This is verse 15. It says this, it's beautifully encouraging. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. Which beautifully leads us to our closing song about shouting and singing and praising God with our heart, our soul, our mind, our energy, our bodies. Sing and shout. Lovely. And I really hope that these songs that we've played today give you something of an earworm for the rest of the week. And as I said earlier, you can find them on our YouTube channel if you want to listen to them again. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this opportunity of coming again around your word. Next week, we're going to be looking at the more solemn case of Easter, but the joy of the resurrection too. But for today, I pray that you'll take us from your presence with a skip in our step and a dance in our heart. In Jesus' name, amen. And so as ever, I bless you with the idea that the Lord Jesus Christ will be with you always, that his peace will be your peace, that his strength will be your strength, and underneath will be the everlasting arms of God. Take care. Speak to you next week.
Your cross, it draws me to your heart. It makes my spirit sing, it makes my spirit sing.